Questions 11 through 20 on the 2003 grade 11 Fermat math contest. In the diagram, it is only possible to travel along an edge in the direction indicated by the arrow. Hazel studied the figure and determined all the possible routes from A to B. She selected one of these routes at random. What is the probability that she selected a route which passes through X? So let's list all the possible routes. This is our starting point A, and initially we're going to X. That's one way of doing this. So I'm going to call this X1 and this X2 and go from there. So our first is AX1 along here and then all the way to XB. So like this. And then similarly, my next one is AX2 and then all the way to XB. All right, so that takes care of the first one. Then we can travel to X, but then we'll go to Y. And then once we get to Y, I'll call this B1, B2, and B3. So that gives me the following routes. I get AX1 to XY to YB1. And then I get AX1 to XY to YB2. And then AX1 to XY, and then YB3. All right, and we get the exact same ones for AX2. And then we pretty much exhausted the A to X, so now we gotta go A to Y. And for A to Y, there's really only three possible routes once you get to Y. Either take B1, B2, or B3. And there you go, this pretty much is all the routes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So there's 11 in total. We want to figure out the probability that we pass through X. Okay, so let's just count the ones that pass through X. It's basically 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 of them. So our probability is 8 over the total, which is 11. So number 11, the answer is A. In the diagram, ABC is equal to 90. AB equals BC equals CD. The length of AD is closest to. So this is a straightforward question involving Pythagoras. AB squared plus BC squared is equal to AC squared. And then plug in what we know, AB is 10, BC is 10, and that will help you solve for AC. So this becomes 200 is equal to AC squared, and therefore AC is the root of 200. And in terms of a number, that will be approximately 14.1. So 14.1 is from A all the way to C, right? But D to C is 10. So AD is basically AC minus DC, and AC/DC, which sounds like a famous rock band from the 1970s. It is a rock band, but AC minus DC in our case is 14.1 minus 10, and therefore AD is equal to approximately 4.1. And they're saying it's closest to, so that would mean 12 is E. If X plus Y is equal to 1 and X minus Y is equal to 3, what is the value of 2 to the power of X squared minus Y squared? So we have X plus Y and we have X minus Y. And we want to find 2 to the power of X squared minus Y squared. Well, X squared minus Y squared, I immediately noticed that that can be factored, X, Y, plus or minus, like that. And that's exactly what we have up here. So we are told that that's 1 and 3. So just substitute it in. 1 and 3, which is 3. So that's it, really. So then 2 to this exponent is 2 to the power of 3, and that is 8. So that's pretty much all that is. So 13, the answer is B. In the diagram, AMN, APQ, QRM, and PRN are all straight lines. The value of A plus B is. So many ways to approach this. This angle is 125, right? So all the angles about a line are equal to 180. So this angle in here plus 125 has to be 180. So therefore that angle is 55. Now this angle in here is opposite to 55, and therefore it will be the same. All right, so far, no tricks. And then this angle in here is going to be 180 minus the 55 minus the A, because all the angles have to add up to 180. And in a very similar way, this angle in here is 180 minus 55 minus B. And therefore this angle is basically this angle subtracted from 180, so that just becomes A plus 55, and in a very similar way, that angle is basically 180 minus this guy, so it becomes 55 plus B. Done. And then this whole shape is our final step. It's basically two triangles, right? If you connect them A to R, you'll see it's two triangles. So every angle in that box, that shape, must total 360. So 360 is equal to 55 plus 125 plus A plus 55 plus 55 plus B. And if you do the math, you'll get that A plus B is equal to 70. So 14, the answer is A. The side lengths of an equilateral triangle and a square are integers. If the triangle and square have the same perimeter, what is the possible side length of the triangle? Okay, so we've got some square and we've got some equilateral triangle, basically. And they're saying that the perimeters are the same. So if the equilateral triangle has side length x and the square has side length y and the perimeters are the same, that basically means that 3x is equal to 4y. So the side length of the triangle is x. So if we isolate for x, we get 4y over 3. Now I can write that a little bit different, 4 times y over 3, like that. So that basically means that whatever x is, it's a multiple of 4. You have to take 4 and multiply it by something in order to get the value for x. So which one of these is a multiple of 4? And after a few seconds, you will notice that the only multiple of 4 listed is 20. So 15, the answer is D. The products of the digits of a 4-digit number is 810. If none of the digits are repeated, the sum of the digits is. So you have this 4-digit number, A, B, C, D, and when you multiply those individual digits together, A times B times C times D, it equals 810. And they want you to figure out what is A and B, C and D, and then add them. So find the sum, A plus B plus C plus D, like that. Okay, this is a trial and error question. So first thing to do is break down 810 into its factors. So it's going to be 2, was that 405, then 5 for sure. And I think that makes it 81. And then 81 is 9 times 9, so that's 3 times 3. Times 3, times 3, like that. All right, so we've got to play with this and figure out what 4 numbers this could be. All right, no problem. Let's say one is 2, and the next one, let's say, is 5. Then the next one could be 3, but then that's going to be 27. 27 is not a digit, right? So I got to backtrack there. How about 9, all right? Sounds good. And then I'm left with a 9. this seems good, but none of the digits are repeated. So, can't use that. So let's start over. No problem. That's what trial and error is all about. Instead of a 2, because that doesn't seem to help me, I'm going to actually combine the 2 with one of the 3s. I can't combine it with the 5 because 2 times 5 is 10, and 10 is not a digit, right? So I'm going to combine it with one of the 3s. That gives me 6. Let's keep the 5. That seems okay. And then I've got these left, so how about just use an individual 3? And then it leaves me with 3 times 3. There you go, 9. That works. And you can verify 6 times 5 times 3 times 9 is indeed 8, 10. Now I've got to find the sum. No problem. 6 plus 5 plus 3 plus 9. And if I remember my addition, I will know that this is 23. So 16, the answer is C. In the diagram, triangle ABC is right angled at C if BD is equal to 2x and DC is equal to x, and the angle ADC is twice the angle of ABC, then the length of AB is. So let's work with this diagram. First, let's fill in what we know. They've actually done that for us, but there's an angle in there that they didn't fill in. Angle ADC is twice of ABC. So if this is, for example, y, this angle, ABC, then that means that this angle is 2y. All right, and I think that's pretty much all they gave us. All right, no problem. This will definitely be 180 minus 2y, because all the angles about a line are 180. And therefore, this angle we can figure out, let's say we call it z, that means 180 is equal to z plus y plus 180 minus 2y. And therefore, if you do the math, you'll get z is equal to y, like that. So since z is y, that means this is y, as we previously indicated. So that means this is isosceles. That is the same as that in terms of its length. So since this is 2x, that means that AD is 2x. Okay? So looks like we're going to have to do the Pythagorean theorem twice in this question. The first one involves this triangle right here, that guy. And that's going to give me DC squared plus AC squared is equal to AD squared, like that. So DC is x, AC is what we're trying to figure out, and AD is 2x, all squared. So this looks like 4x squared minus x squared is equal to AC squared. So AC squared is equal to 3x squared. And therefore, AC is the root 3 of x. So put that in there, root 3x. And then now finally, they want us to figure out AB. So again, another Pythagorean theorem, but this time on the entire triangle. So we've got BC squared plus AC squared is equal to AB squared, like that. BC looks like x and 2x, so that's 3x. 3x squared, AC squared is right here, it's 3x squared. Is equal to AB squared. 3x squared is 9x squared plus 3x squared is equal to AB all squared. So this looks like 12x squared is equal to AB squared. And therefore, the square root of 12x is AB. And of course, that can be written as 2 root 3x. So 2 root 3x is AB, and therefore 17. The answer is C. A car uses 8.4 liters of gas for every 100 kilometers it has driven. A mechanic is able to modify the car's engine at a cost of $400 so that it will use only 6.3 liters of gas per 100 kilometers. The owner determines the minimum distance that she would have to drive to recover the cost of modifications. If gas costs 0.8 per liter, this distance in kilometers is between. So this car was initially 8.4 liters for every 100 kilometers, and the driver paid $400 to make the car now run with only 6.3 liters for every 100 kilometers. And we have to figure out how many kilometers does the driver have to drive in order to recuperate this $400 cost. Okay, so 8.4 liters times the distance, I'll denote that as D, distance D, all over 100 kilometers. This is going to give you the total number of liters. And in this case, it's just 8.4 times D over 100 liters. And because the kilometers cancel, right? Now we have to figure out a cost. And they tell us that it's $0.8 per liter. So that would mean we've got 8.4 D over 10 times $0.8 per liter. And this basically would give me 0.0672 D. All right. And then in a very similar way, we've got 6.3 liters times D kilometers over 100 kilometers. And then that becomes 6.3 times D over 100. And then we have to then multiply that by our cost. So if you multiply that by $0.8 per liter, that's going to give you 0.0504 D. And these are prices, so this is dollars, this is dollars. So he used to have to spend that much, and now he's going to only spend this much. So how much money do we have to recuperate? Well, it's $400. And D can be calculated by subtracting those two. So 0.0672 D minus 0.0504 D. And this becomes 0.0168 D is equal to $400. And if you divide, you'll get D is equal to 23809, 23,809 kilometers. So the question asks you, that distance is in between. So 23,000 is obviously between this range. So 18, then the answer is D. In an art gallery, a 2 meter high painting, BT, is mounted on the wall with its bottom edge 1 meter above the floor. A spotlight is mounted at S, 3 meters out from the wall and 4 meters above the floor. The size of angle TSB is closest to. So first, let's label as much as we can. A lot of this is already labeled, but I think it will be helpful if I draw some lines. I'll draw one line that's basically parallel to the bottom. And what else can I draw? Another line from T parallel like that. And I think that should be it. So let's label this now. Since this is 3, and therefore this is 3. And let's see here. From here to here, it looks like that's 2 plus 1, so that's 3. And therefore, this would be 3. And since the entire distance from S down to F is 4, this little guy in here will be 1. And this is a right angle because of the way I drew it parallel. So Yeah, I think that's all we need. And this little guy in here, this distance, the base of that small triangle, I will denote as x. Okay, so let's begin. I think there's a similar triangle here. So this triangle right here, this small triangle, is similar to this one. It's pretty much kind of a larger version of that same triangle. So that basically means that the sides have the same ratio. So in the small triangle, we got 1 and x, 1 over x. And in the larger one, the distance will basically be from here to here. That's 3, right? Because this is 1. So that's 3. And this is 3. So it's 3 over 3 using similar triangles. So that basically means that x is equal to 1. So x is equal to 1. All right? So if x equals 1, then this little guy is an isosceles triangle. And that means that this angle is the same as that. So we'll just call that, we can just call it z. So 2z plus 90 degrees is 180. And therefore 2z is 90. And therefore z is 45. So that angle in there is 45 degrees. Now the last step to this question is figuring out this angle. All right, no problem. We can use this triangle right there and figure out in it this angle, that whole angle. And once I get it, I'll subtract z from it to get that angle, which is the angle they want us to figure out, TSB. Okay, so here we go. On that triangle, this guy right here, I will use tan. So the tan of this angle right here, from there to there, that whole thing, and that I'll just call that angle S, is opposite over adjacent, so 3 over 1, right? Because this is 3 and that's 1. Those represent the opposite and adjacent to angle S. And if you do the inverse tan, you'll get that S is about 71.5. All right, no problem. So now finally, our angle TSB, this little guy in there, is angle S minus angle Z. So 71.5 minus 45, and that is equal to about 26.5, approximately. So that means it's closest to 19A. If A, B, and C are positive consecutive terms of a geometric sequence, that is C over B equals B over A, then the graph of Y is equal to AX squared plus BX plus C is. So a geometric sequence, the terms are of the form A, AR, AR squared, AR cubed, AR to the fourth, and so on. All right? So that's why they show you this. Because if you take any two and you put one over the other, like AR over A, it will be the same as this over that, AR squared over AR. Because both of these, you'll notice the A's cancel. And in this guy over here, one of the R's cancels too, and you just get left with R. So that's why they put this in here. Now in our case, our consecutive terms are positive and they are A, B, and C. So our first one is A, our second term is B, and our third term is C. All right, so let's plug those in to our equation. Y is equal to A x squared plus B x plus C. And instead of A, I'll put in A, so not much of a substitution there. But B, we get something different, we get AR. And then for C, we get AR squared, and that equals Y. Okay, so that's pretty much as far as we can go with this question, based on what they give us, right? Well, what do we do now? Well, we have to figure out what this graph looks like. And then once we figure out what the graph looks like, we have to read choices A to E and see, okay, which one matches. Well, one thing for sure is that this is a quadratic, right? And therefore, it's going to be a parabola of some kind. But we want to know, okay, what is the nature of that parabola? And the quickest way to do that is to figure out the roots. Once you figure out the roots, we'll get a little bit more information. No problem, set it equal to 0 and use our quadratic formula. All right, so x will be minus b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac, like that, okay, all over 2a. So the top is minus ar plus or minus, we got a squared r squared minus 4a squared r squared all over 2a. And this looks like minus ar plus or minus minus 3a squared r squared all over 2a. So this is about as far as we can go. And one thing you'll notice is that the discriminant is negative. And because the discriminant is negative, that tells you this has no real roots. It does not cross our regular x-axis. Okay, so basically what that means is that this graph is going to look something like this. If you've got a basic graph drawn, it will kind of look something like this. It will never get to the x-axis. Now you say, well, how do you know that it pointed up like that? Why wouldn't it go down like that? Well, because our coefficient a, it's positive. They tell you that. And therefore, it must point up. So this is a very rough diagram of what it looks like. It never, there's no x intercepts. So let's now look at the answer choices. A curve that intersects the x-axis at two distinct points. Well, we've just shown that that's not possible. It has no real roots. So A is gone. Entirely below the x-axis. Well, that's not true. Entirely above the x-axis. Correct. Let's finish this out. A straight line, well, it's not a straight line, it's a parabola. Tangent to the x-axis. Tangent to the x-axis would mean like that, that it touches the x-axis at one point, and that's not true. So 20, the answer is C.